Namaste, Yorubun. Welcome to this video. Today we have Radha here. Radha is my basic level 2 student and today I'll be interviewing her regarding her Korean language journey. And trust me guys, just don't skip this video and watch it till the end because I can guarantee that you are going to learn something from this video because Radha, she is somebody who has been learning Korean language for quite a while. So she can tell you from her experience how her journey has been. So if you are somebody who is stuck in the Korean language journey, or if you're somebody who is actually thinking about starting this language, this video will really help you a lot. So Radhashi, we'll start with the self-introduction. 네, 자기 소개를 해주세요.
안녕하세요, 여러분. 만나서 반가워요. 제 이름은 라다예요. 그리고 저는 19살이에요. 그리고 인도 사람이에요. 대학에서 국어학을 배우는 학생이에요. 그리고 제 취미는 여행하고 음악 듣는 곳이에요. 처음에 드라마 때문에 한국어를 좋아하기 시작했어요. 한국 문화가 너무 좋아해서 한국어를 배우고 있어요.
네, Thank 잘했어요. You. 네, 잘했어요. So, can you just tell our viewers, how did you actually start this language? Like mostly we have Spanish, Italian, like different languages are there. Even Chinese is being learned. So why exactly Korean? And this is my favorite question because I get so many answers from this. So yes, just tell us about your journey from the first time you learned Korean. And why did you do it?
Obviously, I started with dramas. So my first drama was Boys Over Flowers. And I was just streaming through Netflix and I was bored. Ki, like, what am I supposed to see? What am I supposed to see? And then Boys Over Flowers pops up in my recommendation list. So, of course, I fell in love with Lee Min Ho. And after that, I watched all of his dramas. And so, Korean was very different because, like you said, French and German, all of my friends, like most of my friends were either learning French or German. So I was like, oh, Korean is so different. Plus, you know, it has a very different way and it's similar to like kind of the culture is similar to Indian culture. So I was attracted to it a lot, especially like Seoul and stuff.
Even for me, my first drama was City Hunter. So I really liked Lee Min Ho. And later on, I saw Boys Over Flowers also. So those were like the first few dramas which I watched and really loved. But I wouldn't say I started this language from that. Like it doesn't really have any connection. But yes, the love for the culture actually started from there. So like what made you think about learning this language? Like you could have just seen the dramas because you have the subtitles and everything. So why exactly this language?
Okay, so first of all, I'm doing archaeology. So a lot of times archaeologists learn a language because for employment purposes and also like it helps you in your career. So I was thinking about learning a language. Then I got to know that we actually have a connection with Korea. So like, you know, the Queen Suriratna.
Yes, I
Ayodhya to South Korea. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so she married the king over there. So I was fascinated by it. And then I also got to know that they have a small museum made for Rabindranath Tagore. So I was like, me being a history enthusiast, I was like, oh my God, we have a connection with them. So I was like, okay, now this is a very cool language to learn. I have to learn a language. So why not learn a language which has like a historical significance? And I also got to know that the first lady of Korea had visited Ayodhya. So I was like,
even I had studied in my certificate program when I was doing it from Delhi University, like Korea has some connection with India, some related to some queen. I don't really remember, but since you told me now, I'll remember. So yes, that's there. So when you started this language, did you self-study the Hangul characters? Because most of the people, when they start, they are just doing it from somewhere on the internet or just from any of the resources, not really taking any classes at all.
Yeah, that's what I did too. So I learned the language from YouTube, like, you know, the videos, learn the Hangul alphabet in 90 minutes and stuff like that. Mm. I learned the alphabet from there. And then I discovered learnkorean.com. And then I started the basic level from there. And there was also this certificate course run on Coursera by, I think, Yonsei University. So over there, they just teach you the very basic stuff. So I learned from there. Yeah, that was my initial beginning.
Okay, so is the Learn Korean one, like, is a teacher there who is teaching, or is it just, do you just have some videos or something like that?
Oh, wait, it's like the video you've mentioned before too. I don't remember the exact website. You've mentioned it before. How to learn Korean or something like that, no? It doesn't have videos.
Yeah, how to study Korean.
How to study Korean, sorry. Exactly. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So you learned from there.
Yeah, the initial stuff.
Okay, so the initial stuff. So what were actually the difficulties that you faced? Because from the experience that many of my students had, like before they joined my classes, they say that we had some problem with pronunciation and it can get difficult. So what do you think is the difference between self-study, which you did in the beginning, and the classes? And also, do you join my class directly, or were you studying somewhere else in the basic level one? Because you are my basic level two student.
Right. So, first of all, yes, you do experience a lot of difficulties, like the pronunciation, like instead of itta, I would say like issaka and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And then I did join one class, but I think it also depends on the experience of the teacher. So the first class also, I was almost doing self-study. I shouldn't say this. I'm sorry. But yeah. But I think it makes a lot of difference when you join a class, because when you study individually, we can understand grammar, like ki, haan, this is how it is. Yeah, this is how it goes. But you can't bring everything together. So I wasn't able to put everything that I learned in one sentence. And even if I managed to, I didn't know whether I was speaking it or saying it or, you know, writing it the correct way or not. So I think this is like the whole difference.
Even like it'd be hectic if you're learning it through, you know, basically the self-study or from reason, because then you have to learn it via the writing process also and to listen constantly to the pronunciation also. At least if you're taking a class, you know that it's all happening simultaneously. So it's much easier. So in case, like you said, like you would have said itta, you would have said ista instead of ita, right? So there are so many words in Korean which are not really pronounced as they are written. So somewhere you might end up making a mistake when you're self-studying. And it does take a lot of time, because for the beginners, they don't really have resources which they rely on. Like basically, we have the common resources. What are the right resources? That's really difficult to know, according to me. If you're... Okay. So... did you take the real classes or were they online only?
They were online.
They were online. Okay. So since like before the pandemic, people did not really used to rely on the online classes, right? It wasn't something that was trustworthy, because, you know, there are a lot of disadvantages also to online learning. So according to you, do you think that online classes in language are worth it? And what are the disadvantages, basically?
Well, I think they are worth it if you have a good teacher. So I think, first of all, it depends mainly on the teacher. If the teacher is interactive enough, even online, like you are, you ask us questions in Korean, then it's worth it. But there are disadvantages, like when a person is in front of you, you can see everything, like the way he writes, the way he speaks. You get to notice like these small differences, but I think they're being covered up online too. Like everyone is coping up that way.
Yeah, it also depends on what you are willing to do from your side. So for example, since online classes are much cheaper than the real classes, first of all, and second is that it is kind of your responsibility to provide the written stuff that you have basically written to the teacher for correction. If you don't do that, if you're lazy thinking that, okay, I'll study in the class, I won't study the vocabulary, then you are just done. You can't really do anything about that. Because at the end of the day, the teacher can actually correct your listening or the speaking skills. But you, what you are writing, that's really difficult for the teacher if you are taking the online classes. So it becomes your responsibility to send all the assignments to the teacher. And it's like, this is something you have to do, because teacher cannot keep on poking you for the assignments. Right?
That's very true.
That is actually there. So when you exactly start learning the language?
I started learning in 2020. So I got over with my 12th grade and I was like, now I have a lot of time. So why not just like, I was going to start anyways, but because of the pandemic situation, everything was very unclear. So I just started in around June, July 2020.
In June, July. So that time you did the basic level one. And did you take any break or were you self-studying also?
I was self-studying also. So I didn't take really a break. At least I made sure that I started paying more attention when I started watching dramas. Ki, what are they saying? I tried to figure out what they were saying. So I think ki, even if I wasn't technically writing stuff down, but I was like, I didn't exactly take a break.
Okay. So you were kind of always learning every day. Learning. So the dramas also. And yeah. When did you start watching the dramas?
I started watching dramas 3 years ago.
Oh, okay. It's been a long time. And like, it's like a long gap between watching the dramas and learning the language.
Learning the language, right.
Okay. So when you started learning Korean, what were the difficulties that you faced? Like every person, from what I have seen in my students, some people struggle with writing. Some people struggle with the listening part or the speaking part. Some weaknesses are there which get covered up later on. But so according to you, on your personal thing, what was the difficulty which you had to face?
Okay, so the first difficulty was obviously the writing part, because we say khunchana, but we write it in a very different way. So they have like these blocks, right? You have to write the consonant over here, vowel over here.
The syllable structure.
Syllable structure. So that was a bit difficult for me to memorize. I literally, in the initial part, I started memorizing the way they were written. And then it started coming naturally. And then the second most one was when we had to conjugate it. So like we have itta and you have to make it issoyo, then issosoyo, and then issalkoy. So like, you know, the future, present, past thing. And then the main word. So that was a bit difficult initially. So then I made a table and then I memorized it too. So that was very difficult.
And the honorifics? Like you have the formal and informal. They are
informal. Yeah, the honorifics too, because honorifics are a very different thing for me now. They are very hard for me, at least till now. I hope that they won't be so hard after completing my intermediate. But because honorifics are very different. I understood the conjugation part, but I don't understand when we have to put that ismida stuff.
Yeah, and it becomes more difficult when you actually start to speak with some Korean, because then you have to make sure that you are not using the oyo or io wala conjugation. You have to use the formal wala conjugation. So it's like a really a hectic thing when you are actually doing that in real life. So it can be a challenge. So what was the most fascinating, or I would say the thing that you liked the most about the Korean language, something that you just love doing, whether it's the grammar or the vocabulary, anything related to Korean?
First of all, I love the way Korean is spoken. I don't know why, but I like the way it sounds. And I was fascinated when the grammar structures are very similar to Hindi. So a lot of times, instead of English, I write it down in Hindi because it's easier. Sometimes when I write the translation down in English, it gets a bit confusing. But when I write it down in Hindi, it's exactly vaise ka vaisa. You know, the way we say it. So I was fascinated by that. I was like, okay, this is a bit easy, but it is not that easy, of course. But that was what fascinated me. Yeah, the most.
Okay. So since you know that Korean language is actually a very challenging language, okay? I wouldn't say it's difficult, because for the one who really likes doing it, for them it wouldn't really be a difficult thing. But it is definitely challenging and it takes time. So what according to you is the amount of time that one needs to put into it? Because definitely if you're doing it like once in a week, it doesn't really work that way. You're going to forget. Right. So what does one have to do if they are just, apart from the classes part? Because class mein toh teacher is doing this stuff. But when you are not in the class, what exactly should be done in order to learn Korean in a better manner?
Well, I think first of all, whatever we've learned in class, we should try using it in real life. So I do this a lot. So I talk to myself. I literally talk to myself because I don't have anyone to practice with, especially in quarantine. So if my mom is like, let's have dinner, then I'll shout, let's have dinner in Korean. So I think you should start speaking to yourself, like on basic levels, like basic conversations. And I started writing my diary. So I've been writing it consistently for a few days. So I think writing diaries helps a lot. So you get to know.
It is actually very helpful.
Yeah, where you stand, when you actually start expressing yourself, you're like, oh, I don't know this. You just...
Exactly. Because in the class or even when you're doing the vocabulary, you are just doing the general vocabulary, right? The one that should be learned at basic level. But when you write a diary, you are expressing the thoughts that you have in you. And basically the vocabulary that you usually use comes out in a diary. So that way you can get to know about the vocabulary, about that particular vocabulary in Korean. So it's more useful according to me because that is something that you'll be using in daily life anyway. So through that, you are actually learning new vocabulary. So that's, I think, more helpful in that way. And also you are able to form sentences in a more natural manner rather than just, you know, making one-liners in the class. Because in the class, you can't really do a lot of stuff except for learning the grammar or just some of the vocabularies. So in order to really understand Korean and how to make sentences in different manner, you need to write diary or just, you know, put down vocabulary and try to make as many sentences as you can through all those vocabularies. So that is like really a helpful thing.
Yes, okay. It is.
So what do you think should be done for speaking? Because, you know, as you know, in India, we don't have any Korean. So what would you recommend a beginner level person should do in order to improve Korean? Because as a beginner, you're at a level where you can't really converse with a Korean person because your vocabulary set, your grammar is lower than a normal native person. So how do you recommend a person?
First of all, when you learn the basic grammar, like this is this, like this is a book, this is that, that is a watch. So I think you should start forming basic sentences. And second thing which I did was that I used to mimic dramas. So like there's this learning mode in Wiki. So you can go on the learning mode. So there's like the English subtitle and the Korean subtitle. So like even on Netflix, they have Korean subtitles. Turn off the English and put on the Korean subtitles. And once you know how to read it, so you can just like, you don't have to do the entire episode. Just sit over there for 15 minutes and try to mimic them like the way they pronounce it. So like, the way they pronounce small things. So then you start improving your speaking on your own.
That's there. Even if you learn here a new word, you can directly from English switch to Korean. See the word. Because on Wiki, everything is like it's 100% Korean. So it's not auto-generated. So it's pretty accurate. And another thing is that you also have in web dramas, which I discovered some months ago. So these are the web dramas which are just maybe 5-10 minutes long. So for a person who wants to practice this, because you know, if you turn off the subtitles in a Korean drama which is like 1 hour long, even 1 minute can get really, really hectic and tiring. So if you choose a good web drama which is like all over the YouTube, so that is still a better option because the kind of language they use is more native and it's more natural from my own ears. Whereas in dramas, it is native but not very, very natural. It's just suit all kinds of audience, full in that way. And obviously speaking to yourself, because at this level you can't really expect to speak to a Korean person, but later on after intermediate level that you can develop that kind of level to actually start speaking. So you said that you love the Korean culture. So what exactly is it about Korea that you like apart from the language?
Well, when I said culture, it's very similar because like we also eat together on the dining table, and Koreans also prefer eating together. They prefer doing stuff together. Also, the schools are similar to us, like the pressure put on students, and also like they have uniforms too. So I think that's what I liked about the culture. They respect their parents too, and whereas we have the same amount of respect given for elders.
That's cultural, really great. They bond over food. So in some culture you don't talk while eating food, but in Korean culture you have that thing that, you know, basically families come together on the dinner table. So that's the kind of culture even Indians have. It is something relatable. So after you learned Korean at this level, since you've been studying it for quite some time, do you think there has been any kind of difference in the way you understand Korean in the Korean dramas obviously you're at basic level right now, but are you able to understand Korean to some level in dramas? Like, what's the difference that you felt after learning Korean?
Yeah, I think I started learning the basic stuff because it's basic level, obviously. But after the vocabulary that you've given us, I obviously conjugated the vocabulary too. And I can understand a lot, in fact. I was watching one of the V-Lives of BTS, and weirdly, they were just talking about their daily day-to-day stuff. Like, I just had food, and then I was doing this. And I was like, oh, I'm able to understand this. I wasn't able to understand the complex sentences. But if a person comes to you and starts speaking in Korean, I think you will be able to understand 50% if you do your basic level well.
Or even you can make some guesses with their expression, or just pick up some or the other word. That way you can understand what they are saying. So it's easier that way. Even like, I think Hangul is very important with the people who are interested in Korean, because there are people who are interested in K-pop, but you know, they are more dependent on the romanization, which according to me messes up your pronunciation so badly, because Koreans don't really read the words that they write in the right manner. They have like different kinds of pronunciation. So if you're depending mainly on romanization, you can't really expect to speak at a, you know, very natural tone. So that is not something I recommend ever. So if somebody is interested in Korean, at least the least they can do is learn the Hangul, which is so easy. It's like the easiest script in the world. One can learn it in a day. So it's like really helpful that way if they want to actually be able to understand K-pop or K-dramas.
Okay. Yeah.
So the next question is that, so right now you're learning the Korean language, and do you have any plans for the intermediate level or advanced level?
Yeah, of course I do. I want to do it till advanced. So
till advanced level.
I want a topic level 5 certificate.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, that was my question. That, do you have any future goals related to Korean? Like, what exactly do you have in your mind? Because you're an archaeology student, right? So this Korean is something that is kind of unrelated only, not very, very related.
Yeah, very related.
So what are your plans regarding this language? Because since you say that you want to do it till advanced level, so what would you like to do with this language? Because it can't just be dramas, right?
Yeah, so obviously I wanted to complete it to topic level 5, and then I am planning of, you know, becoming a linguist and probably getting a job in a Korean company after my graduation.
But that would be completely unrelatable, right? Because you are
but of course I love archaeology, but a lot of times in archaeology it takes a bit of time to get a job. So until then, until I complete my master's or PhD, and in fact, I've been also learning it from a perspective of going abroad to study. So I actually checked their universities and stuff. They have Buddhist studies. So, and there is a different department in archaeology called Art History and Buddhism, which covers the spread of Buddhism from India. So yeah, so they have their master's courses in that too. So I'm also thinking ki maybe I could go, but I don't think I will go right now. But yeah, I want to do it. And then from a job perspective, I'm learning it.
Possible. Like, you can even apply for the scholarship if you want. Maybe if not now, since you're in undergraduation, right?
Tuition.
So when you do your master's, you can probably apply for the scholarship, which would be much easier on your pocket because you don't have to spend anything. And plus, the thing is that if you're learning Korean, for somebody who is not learning Korean, and if they go for the scholarship, they probably might not get selected unless like they have a lot of credibility, very good score, because the Koreans or Korean universities prefer somebody who has some or the other link with the Korean culture, with the Korean language. So if you go and tell them, the university during the scholarship, that I have done Korean language, I have been doing some, you know, contributing something in this culture, they will be more impressed. You get extra points. So that way your chances increase for going to Korea and studying there. Okay. So you would like to give the topic level?
Yes, I would.
Joining Korean company, as you see nowadays, there are so many Korean companies set up in India. So very less people who are studying Korean, everybody is interested in K-pop, but very less people who are studying properly and a lot of job opportunities. So that way the salary is really, really high even for freshers. So it's an advantage for Korean learners. And even if you see in the embassy, in the teaching, in journalism, there are a lot of opportunities. Like the market is very, very big for this language. It's really helpful that way. So Radha, would you like to give any tip, any kind of tip for all the people who are just beginning their language journey? Because you also started just some time ago. So anything that you would like to say to help them?
First of all, I think anyone who learns Korean is genuinely interested in Korean. Just don't learn it because of any purpose is small, but just for the sake of, you know, time pass, don't learn it. If you want to learn it sincerely, because like every language is hard. You will realize it once you start learning it. And I would actually advise you guys to learn from classes, because then you guys won't be confused. Like I was initially reading Issida instead of Itta, and such mistakes would be. Yeah, it saves time. Yeah, it saves a lot of time. And also make sure that you try to apply whatever you've learned. So even if you're making 5 sentences a day, that's okay. But once you start doing that, the higher levels will start getting easier.
Yeah, it does. It gets harder also, but it gets easier to understand. Because you get into that mode of learning language and, you know, you have already taken the challenge from the basic level itself. So you are already prepared for the levels that come later on. Also, I feel that if you join the classes in the beginning itself, or if you have any mentor, it's much better, because learning the right pronunciation from the beginning is better than learning the wrong one through self-study. And then later on, you know, rectifying it, then that thing takes a lot of time, because that is in your mind already, the wrong pronunciation. So it's better to always have a mentor, at least for the beginning, I say. Okay, Radhashree, it was really, really nice talking to you. And this was the first interview, actually, that I was conducting. So I plan on making a series for some of the students that have been doing really well in this language. I really hope you join the intermediate level, because I know that you are studying really hard for Korean. And, you know, you give me so many assignments that you have already done. So it's really a good job that you're doing. So keep doing it, doing the vocabulary and the grammar, because it's such a beautiful language, you know, and I feel so good when I find people who have the same enthusiasm. Because some people join classes, from my own experience, some people join classes and they don't study. They completely rely on the classes. But it doesn't work that way. 50% effort has to be yours. So it feels really good when somebody is giving effort, because people want to be fluent, but they don't want to do study outside of the classes. And study outside of the classes at your home, the self-study is really important along with the classes. That's how you get fluent in a language, in any language that you take. So that's like my recommendation, that if you are taking classes, don't completely depend on it. Do your self-study. It helps a lot. Like Radha said, write diary. Make your own sentences, talk to yourself if you don't have anybody, because giving the excuse that there's no Korean in India and we don't have opportunity to talk. I have seen many people getting fluent even though they didn't have any Korean friends. People are like that because they are working hard. They actually find ways to, you know, improve their skills in some or the other way. So, you know, you always have doors open. So Radhashree, it was very nice talking to you.
Kumasmida.
De, kamsahamnida, Radhashree. De,
안녕히 계세요.
네, 안녕히 계세요.